We now have with us the Executive Director of the Center for Media Freedom and Responsibility, Ms. Melinda de Jesus. Good morning, ma'am, and thank you very much for joining us again on the program.
Good morning, Christian.
First, what do you think of this arrangement coming from Malacanang that private media won't be allowed to cover the State of the Nation address of the President on Monday from the Batasang Pambansa?
I think most media organizations are going to accommodate the adjustments that are made in the light of the threat of the pandemic of COVID. What we have thought about and have been trying to present to the idea is that it is possible to hold the pooled coverage as they do when there are these kinds of limitations of space. It's not limitation of space so much in this situation, but what is definitely out of question would be the fact that we would be hooked on only to the government's coverage, meaning we are dependent on their angles. Private media cannot select how it will move about or its coverage, its cameras, who it will pick up or what it will say, etc. And I think this is considered a definite, direct prevention, curtailment of access of media and therefore the access of the public to a more credible presentation of the SONA. We are not dismissing the issues that are presented by the IATF, but definitely there are ways of getting around this in terms of arranging for pooled coverage, meaning you have limited number of media that can go in there. But they will at least be the ones to feed what they have to the others. And this is done as a matter of course, every time there are limitations.
Okay, that's
so
important.
So I think the government should rethink its position on this because there is no point in asking private media to carry the government's coverage. It just doesn't work that way.
Okay, let's talk a bit about the basics here, basic journalism. What's a problem, for example, if all the private media entities will be dependent on the angles, on the shots, on the videos coming from the government itself, from a purely journalistic point of view? And number two, of course, it's good that you clarified what we mean by pool, because a lot of people might not understand the push by some private media organizations to be allowed to cover. When you say pooled coverage, we're not saying that everyone should be there. But
absolutely
only limited
not.
Number. Okay.
Yes, definitely. Each sometimes this is the pool is determined by a raffle as to which organization goes to represent which platform, and clearly, it's a mechanism that is accepted by universally, and it is up to the media and the host organizations to be able to settle amongst themselves this particular arrangement. But to make us completely dependent on the coverage of the media is to spread only the media, the government's perspective. And that is the issue here. We become then the vehicles that carry the state and the mechanisms and the communication that is determined by government. Well, that basically unifies everything into the voice of the state and the voice of the government, the voice of propaganda, if we have to be very candid about it, since we do know that much of the resources of the government's communication is dedicated to propaganda. And propaganda that is sometimes based on false narratives, based on false perspectives, and the controlling of it has been just so demonstrated in the recent times that the media really cannot allow themselves to be part of this mechanism.
So the concern is that everyone might be reduced to being PTB4 or Radyo ng Bayan when it comes to perspectives.
That's what it will do, you see, because their problem is if they reduce it to PTB4, then it is reduced to the audience of PTB4, which has proven time and again that it does just not draw that kind of audience unless it's featuring a tournament, a sports game. And so it's really to my mind, the issue of the government's credibility so far. I mean, it could have had a government service that people will want to watch. It has not. And that's something that they have to worry about. To my mind, I think the audience, the public, should be very well aware about what the issues that are being manipulated because there is COVID. Mm-hmm. It is as though it has become a blanket with which to cover everything that the government wants to do in terms of its own communication. And I think the public is the only real check to that. The media can facilitate it by basically sharing the kind of perspective or the view that they hold about this. And the public should think about it and basically evaluate for themselves how they want to see the SONA. I would rather that the government just basically does not, if it doesn't wish to provide that pooled mechanism, then the media needs to just decide that it will not cover. It will cover it post facto. It will cover it after it has received whatever it has received from every other source and basically present its own perspective again, as it does and it has to do and should do anyway, every time there is a national event in coverage.
So I just want to clarify that particular suggestion of yours. We don't need to cover it live, but we can air it after and put more context into it.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Okay. Right. Now, I think people should also understand, you mentioned the COVID-19 as the pandemic being used as some sort of a blanket excuse to actually limit the media access. Why is it even more important at this time to allow independent media to cover events by the administration, given the things that are happening now? For example, I would like to cite one case in the event in Hulo. The president delivered a speech, and it turned out that Malacanang actually took out crucial parts of the speech because that would have shown that his spokesmen were lying, that the president in fact referred to ABS-CBN when he said that he had dismantled oligarchy.
It also revealed what had been denied for effortlessly, I think, has been denied that the president had anything to do with the closure of ABS-CBN. I mean, he basically admitted it there. And I think this is the crux of the splicing of that particular speech, is that it contradicted the false narrative that it came out. It came out with the truth. So that's one. And the whole idea of presenting it as an official transcript, to my mind, is the lie. Because PTV4 can do its propaganda. It can cut its and edit if it wants. It's the only outlet. But official transcripts, the audio clips that were available, that is what the media picks up and should pick up, because that is where the truth lies. And this has to do so much with the issue of competence and the issue of credibility. If you're going to try and do damage control, then you have to know what's going on in your own backyard. And clearly this has come out, unfortunately for them, that it showed them not quite on the ball on what they were doing. And as far as credibility, then we must need to ask, what is the truth of anything that comes out of the communications office in Malacañang? Why are we spending so much money when we don't even or cannot trust the information that government provides? Mm. This brings the whole process into some deeper evaluation, deeper thinking, deeper processing on the part of the public, which I think for much of the administration, it was perfectly willing to give in, to give out, based on the false narratives that were initiated from the very beginning. I mean, the government has had great practice in doing what it's been doing because we had also, in general, some of the media been compliant, complicit with the whole presentation of things according to how the government wants to present it. And this creates what? A herd mentality. It creates a nation of sheep. Not willing to question, not willing to ask, not willing to seek more sources for the truth that they want and they need, particularly in times of crisis where their lives are at stake. And so it goes on, not just from the issue of the splicing of the that speech. It goes on as well to all the fundamental questions that we face, existential questions, for example, as to how we are going to move forward, how the Healing Bayanihan Act has been implemented, where that money has gone, where the money is going that has been received from all the governments. The accountability of government has been raised to a level, I think, at which most Filipinos should be concerned. Deeply concerned about.
Okay, Ms. Melinda de Jesus, thank you very much for joining us this morning.
Thank you, Kirsten.